Today we're delighted to have Mr. Noriyuki Matsuda, who is the founder and CEO of SourceNext, and he's a director of the Japan Association of New Economy. And this is our series in this public forum series of patterns of harnessing Silicon Valley, because that's one of the great things, great challenges that faces a lot of us. So we have several questions for him, and he'll talk about his story. And I think it's good to start with a few of the worst practices that we'll leave the best practices to consultants. But here at a university with a long time span, we've seen many of the worst practices on how not to make use of Silicon Valley, because it usually doesn't work. So I have a list. We'll eventually have this on the website in a more organized form. But a lot of firms that try to make use here, and it's not just Japanese firms. But Japanese firms definitely have these problems, right? First, you make a Silicon Valley office, but you're isolated. And then you try to get appointments with interesting startups, because that's your mission, but you do not have a track record in Silicon Valley, so you can't get traction. People don't meet you. But headquarters is not sympathetic. Instead, we are this company. Everybody comes and visits us. What do you mean you cannot get appointments? And so the person over here has to sell their own company, saying, look, we do this and that, even though we don't have a track record, please meet us. And then to headquarters, say, well, this is how Silicon Valley works. And you get stuck in between. And so often then these local offices becomes a travel agency. different people from headquarters come. And it's not just Japanese firms. In December, we'll have somebody who was in a Singapore and UK bank who had a Silicon Valley office that turned into a travel agency. And she came in and basically transformed it to make it meaningful. And then another problem, challenge, is usually the slow speed. Okay, we met a startup, we finally were able to meet, a good synergy, all right, let's do business, we can have a deal here. The startup needs an answer in 2 to 3 weeks at the longest, and headquarters says, okay, that sounds very good, please wait 3 months for the, because if it's over a certain amount, we have to take it to the board, etc. And this usually doesn't work. So then 3 months later, when they say, okay, we've approved this deal, okay, now go get it. They say, well, sorry, the deal is no longer. I say, well, it's your fault. Why couldn't you keep them at the table? And you say, no, they're already been bought out by somebody else. There was a different deal. This speed difference. And then lack of support from headquarters when the boss changes. The company wants to send people out here. There's lots of headquarters support. Good things, but then things change in the headquarters, and then you're left like a kite whose string has been snapped. So basically, there's no good headquarters support anymore, and so then you become isolated over here and have difficulty doing deals. And then sometimes also, it's difficult to get the sensation of what it's like to be here and transfer that to headquarters. So for example, I've talked to CEOs in Japan who are very skeptical, saying, well, why would you have Teslas? Okay, Tesla, fine, it's a little company, it doesn't do scale. Autopilot, why would you let a machine drive it? Oh, very dangerous. Do people actually use that? If you're here, I take my son to daycare and we ride from one bicycle from one side of Stanford to the other side. We counted 6 Teslas the other day. The Sony store in Stanford Shopping Center turned into a Tesla store. There are lots of Teslas. Lots of people use autopilot. It's real. How can we get Aichi Prefecture engineers to get this? How can we get the top management in Hiroshima, these are all auto companies, to get a sense of how real this is? Well, you can bring them here. But then we get into the travel agency problem. And so what's the best way? It's a real challenge. And then short time horizon. So if you're from a big company and your mission is 2 years, or 1 year, or 3 years, then you have a very short time horizon. It takes several months to get your life up and running. Then you make a personal network. Let's say it's a 3-year term. It takes a year for you to get up and running and then make a personal network of people. Second year, you go forward and you start doing deals. This is great. And then your third year, people start to ask, so how long have you been here? Oh, 2 years. How long will you be here? Maybe another year. Very nice to meet you. And then they go away, because they know that you're not going to necessarily be able to transfer the relationship to the next person. And so then the time horizon gets shorter and shorter, and the interpersonal direct relationships don't work. And if somebody asks you, well, who's coming next? You don't know, because it hasn't been assigned yet. And then the transfer overlap period can be very short, so you can't actually introduce your successor to everybody else. And then you've just wasted quite a bit of time making interpersonal network that disappears. Fine. People in Silicon Valley have had this happen to them for 20 years. So that's why it's difficult when they say, OK, I'm from such and such a company. I'm new here. I don't know much. Please teach me this and that. They'll say, well, we did that to your predecessor's predecessor, several generations of people, and we still don't have a deal yet. So it was nice to meet you, and they go elsewhere. So how to get, and short time horizon should be something that Japanese big companies are good at avoiding, because it's not like the CEO changes every few quarters, and performance shouldn't be. But actually, the Silicon Valley branch is very short time horizon, which goes against the strengths of Japanese companies. So then, and there are just a couple more, I started out to make 10 worst practices, and it got longer and longer. But and there are cases that have overcome this, and that's why it's so fun to get Mr. Matsuda here today. So then the CEO visits. And the CEO visit, if you're the bigger the company, the bigger deal it is. So the local person spends 2 months planning the CEO visit, and then spends all their social capital to try to get appointments in different places. CEO comes. It's great. They're excited. They meet different people. They come here. We talk to them. And then they say, OK, let's go. But for many companies, then the issue goes to middle management, who's much more conservative. They didn't come here. They didn't see the Teslas. They're not sure what Google really, its impact is. And they say, well, OK. And so the CEO is excited. The people over here are excited. And then in headquarters, it dies a slow death in between. And then things don't happen. So how to avoid this? And then, of course, it's difficult to hire local people. We've had cases where big Japanese firms come. They have a very interesting service. They'd like to they send one person here. They need to hire a few more people. But if it's an inexperienced firm, the personnel policy, they'll say, well, the personnel policy has to be controlled by our headquarters according to our salary scale. And they say, well, our salary is very modest, but can you come work for us? The answer is usually no. So they can't get people to work. And the service then gets outpaced. So how to evaluate people? How do you hire people here who cost a lot if you don't have experience evaluating who's high cost, high performance, and who's high cost, low performance? Because there are plenty of people here that are not high performance, but they cost a lot. So how do you differentiate this? And then how do you explain this to headquarters? Now, the point here is that Matsuda-san has solved many of these problems. A lot of these problems that big firms run into, he's solved partly because he's the CEO that lives here. His company is in Tokyo. And the only employee that lives here, there isn't an employee. He's the CEO and the founder who lives in Silicon Valley. This pattern was very new. We've written about this, and it's interesting. So with that very long introduction, Matsuda-san, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And today, I think it would be very useful if we do this as a conversation. And I've divided some questions that I'd like to ask in several portions. First is the Matsuda-san story, the entrepreneurship portion. And then the Silicon Valley portion, experience coming to Silicon Valley. And then Matsuda-san has a very important role in a very important new organization in Japan, which is the Japan Association of New Economy, which is a new business organization that's pushing policy in very interesting ways. Most people looking at Japan from the outside only know Keidanren, and this is a new organization that's actively having a policy impact. So these are the three. So starting with the entrepreneur portion. Matsuda-san, can you tell us about your experience starting your own company, starting with your background, et cetera?
Okay, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for joining.
I worked for IBM Japan for 4 years and 5 months, and then I quit IBM Japan. But IBM, a really good company, yes. For many, everybody say, IBM is more like not Japanese, oriented company, but actually it's more like Japanese company in terms of seniorities and everything. So I thought, and then the reason why I quit actually IBM was I was headhunted by Lehman Brothers, and I was headhunted by one more company, the startups in New York, and they are looking for a general manager in Japan. And then actually that offer was really good. At that time, my salary was about $60,000, they offer me over 150. So that's good for a 28 years old person. So I signed a contract. But actually, before I joined the company, there was a telephone conference with spreadsheet. I think at that time, Lotus 1-2-3, maybe. Please give me a business plan with how many people you hire and how much revenue can you generate next 3 years, 5 years. And I just sent a spreadsheet, and then Nori, you cannot hire this kind of person at $60,000. It's too expensive, too high. What? I'm GM and I cannot decide even my employee salary? That's not good, because after I signed a contract, actually I called many of my friends, and then why don't you join my company? Because it's good. And then he has family, he has kids, but if I cannot decide my salary, that's a huge problem. So I cannot take responsibility. So I should have full control, I thought. And then how can I decide my employee salary? Maybe only solution is found my company. So actually, until 28 years old, I never thought of founding a company. My father was working for a tax office for 35 years. So I don't have any entrepreneurship, but I think that was the reason.
And in college, you were a mathematics major?
Yeah, mathematics. I majored in mathematics. Yeah. And actually, I grew up in Osaka. I never been to actually Tokyo. I never been to US until 20 years old. So I'm really domestic person. I'm really Kansai person. So I really hated Tokyo at that time.
I see. So were there specific times other than getting, so you got headhunted, and that was the critical juncture for saying, okay, I'm going to leave the big company that everybody says should be the good career path.
Yeah, at that time, now, of course, maybe we were trying to find a company, but at that time, 1993, actually, very few people, and especially from IBM. If IBM is good company for Japanese people, so actually my wife's mother really shocked. That's a response, I think.
Was there other pressure from inside the company where people are saying, well, don't leave or you're doing terrible?
Oh, yeah, they said that. Yeah, but actually, I think because I was 28 years old, I saw the few risks. If I was 40 years old, maybe 50, because I could make more money, right? At that time, it's low salary, so very few risks. I could work for other company, so the reason why I maybe decided because I was only 28 years old, so I thought almost no risk. Yeah.
Were people at the company, one of the things that often comes up is people that leave large companies, if the large company could use them as alumni and have it as assets like McKinsey does, there's a McKinsey OV, but a lot of big companies are not very good at that. Say, how dare you leave? Now you've left, never show your face here again. And which is too bad, because a lot of people could then maybe make a company and come back, get bought out. Was this sort of the culture? Because it was still unusual in the early 90s.
I don't know. I think in the case of IBM, I think it's pretty IBM people leave and then work for GM of a big company like Oracle or Sun Microsystems. But not the reason I found my company.
Right.
Yeah, very few. Even now, I think two or three companies, the person who leave the IBM and found a company and go for public. Mm. I think two or three, yeah.
Okay. So you founded the company.
Yeah.
And then what was your first business? So was it called Source Next to begin with?
First one was AAA, and then I found a software, and it's called SourceNext. Yeah, so this is the second company. Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. How did the first company go?
Well, first company, just consulting. Mm-hmm. I was a system engineer, so I didn't know anything about sales. Mm-hmm. So I studied like consultant, maybe that's engineer, but I worked for directory for like AIG or Abico, this kind of a company.
I see. Yeah. I see.
But a consulting business, I thought, really tough. So because when I make money, I do the consulting. That's the only way to make money. So that's the only time I can make money. But if I sell something, even now I sell like a lot of software. If I'm talking, mm-hmm. It's products still sold, and then I can make money, right?
Right.
So earning money and then working time has to be separated. That's what I thought. And then I went to Seattle, and then I found many educational software for kids. I thought, oh, this is a great product. I think I should bring over to Japan, and I can sell in Japan. Maybe that's a good idea for the Japanese people and for the American people. That was SourceNext. That was 1996.
I see. So did you? So you're essentially a licensing business?
Yeah, license business. Yes.
I see. Yeah. So, and in 1996, you said yeah. So that was still was it still DOS-V back then?
No, Windows. Windows 95.
Right.
Was okay. Just come out.
Right.
Yeah, but it's still many people using DOS or NEC DOS or.
Right. In. Was it difficult for you to do deals to bring the software to Japan?
Oh yeah, of course. But I was so lucky. All distributors, at that time, the current distributor was not doing very well, a good job. So I was so lucky, and I talked to them, and then maybe you can distribute it. Yes, I did it. But I didn't know actually anything about distribution system in Japan. I didn't know even about SoftBank at that time. My simple idea is, okay, I create some box and then bring to the Akihabara and then sell it by myself. Maybe that works, I saw. And actually that worked.
So you brought boxes of software, sold them in.
Yeah, I was setting the PC software to the customer at the retail stores directory and then face to face. So that was my very good experience. So I could understand what the customer needs because I could talk to a customer every week. So that was good.
Yeah. I see. Because, especially during the mid to late 90s, one of the things, this was during the US-Japan trade friction era, and one of the things that foreign firms and startups, it was seen as a barrier was distribution. How do you get distribution in Japan? Because that's a barrier to entry. Mm-hmm. And you found that as a new startup, just bringing things in, and you worked hard, but you also were personally on the floor.
Yes.
And then how did it get bigger and bigger? It just started to...
That's actually one reason, just customer focus, customer center, that's a key. So because I was at the real retail shop and talking to the customer told me, oh, you were selling the mathematics for kids? Why don't you sell English for kids, running English for kids? Okay, and at first, because some other English running software from other company, so I had to sell the product, but I don't know this product, I cannot take responsibility. So I thought, maybe I go to US again, and I find a great product to teach English for kids. So I brought over again. And the next one is, oh, why don't you sell games like Warcraft, Diablo? Okay, I went there, and then I got the rights. And not only that, why don't you sell utilities? Utilities more like Speed Doubler, RAM Doubler, or Mac, but it's no Windows. So I found a great product in Seattle. So it's that's doing like this, and it's so the third year, SourceNext revenue already hit the $30 million. For this edition, so. And then 1999, I found McAfee, and I signed the contract. And that was, I think, a big deal. That's the third year of SourceNext, yeah.
I see.
Yeah.
Wow, what were some of the challenges in the early years to try to scale it if you hadn't built a big company?
Scale, even I make money, of course, cash flow, always some problem. Yeah, that's a key, Yeah, the cash is always a problem for the kid. And then I was an engineer, so I didn't know how to raise the money. This is like more like a business oriented. So I didn't even issue the invoice, right? I didn't even know the terms. Common 30 days. And in Japan, I like a counterpart with like a D&B. It's called it's like a summer institution to check if the company is okay or not. Mm-hmm. The name in Japanese, I forgot. Credit rating company. Yeah. And they asked me, what's your term for the payment? And I didn't understand. So many things I didn't know a lot of basic terms. Yeah, so that was a big challenge for me. Because I was an engineer, I didn't even go to
You had to learn how to, right.
Oh,
no, go ahead.
No, scaling, yes, but it's just, I think it's just customer focus, and then I know customer wants, and I go to America or go to other countries and get the product and bring over, sign a contract. See, this circulation, I think, worked very well, except the cash flow. The cash flow problem, I got to raise some money from other retailers, like Yodobashi Camera, so I was so lucky. But mostly after that, I started a new strategy. It's a commodity strategy, which is I set the price, all the price to $20 for all kind of software. Mm. That was I tried because this PC software was so expensive. So that was a big challenge, and that was huge scale. Actually, that created a huge scale.
I see.
Yeah, because it's $20. I started to sell at $20 for like a Sun Microsystems Star Office or any Lotus 1-2-3 or security software McAfee. Everybody was so surprised, and everybody say, hey, SourceX can sell at $20 because they are not spending any money for development. That's why, and everybody say that. So that was really hard time for us because it's everybody actually say $20 doesn't work because for retailers not good because they want to sell the a higher price one and then distributor of course not happy and the company which brings the contents they are not happy they want to make us sell the higher price but the consumers end user really happy. If $20, they can buy five copies and then only $100. So when I watched actually a movie, it's Titanic, and I come up with really good idea. They say because SourceX can do at $20 because we don't spend any development fee for that, very few development fee. But Titanic is $240 million cost. But if you go to the movie theater, Titanic is $500? No, $200? No, that's $10, $12. So the movie industry, even the very expensive movie, I mean, in terms of development cost, it's all the movie are same price. And the movie same, the music is same. But PC software was not. And after I come up with this idea, I talked to the many retailers, distributors, and they understood. And after that, we sold 5 million copies a year. 5 million times $20 would be over $100 million. So that was a big challenge for SourceX. But that was good for, I think, it's end users, for everybody.
Oh, interesting. So in the early stage, was it sort of like this? Japan was more of a Galapagos market because there was there's the NEC version of things too, but also because it just wasn't distributed. And you were able to bring in things that people wanted. Mm-hmm. And then later, you brought a business model disruption by making it flat fee instead of a small volume, high price thing. You did a low price and then attained rapid scale. And then was it right after that you did your IPO?
IPO was 2006, so 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. The commodity strategy was started at 2003, so 3 years before that. So after that, actually pricing to $20, not only that, the distribution, we changed the distribution. So not only, usually PC software, you got to go to like Best Buy here. Mm-hmm. In Japan, like a Ryobashi Camera or Big Camera or Yamada Electronics. But we started selling at bookstores, convenience stores, because it's $20. So we made the package smaller. Mm. That was a big, huge package.
Right. It used to be big.
Yeah, so we changed many things, not only that.
I see.
And the next things that we tried is the security software's update fee becomes zero. That's what we did. So usually, like Mac fee, Symantec, Trend Micro, they are making money to sell security software by yearly income, by yearly update fee. Hey, you can use it, but every year you have to pay $30, $40. That's the common sense, right? But I thought, why should we collect that money? Maybe make it zero. Once you buy, you don't have to pay anymore. Because it's every year, it's kind of annoying. Why don't you buy this? Oh, your time expired within 90 days. This message, nobody likes that. Right. And then actually, the reason why I come up with this idea is because my dad, my father always call me every year. It's coming like within 60 days, it's expired. How can I do it? And he lives in Osaka. Yeah. I live in Tokyo. So I got to go back to Osaka. That costs like $200 at least. to update only $40, you know? that's ridiculous, I thought. And then, so if we eliminate that update fee, that's really good for the customer, for sure. Mm-hmm. But it's good for the companies. And we got to go to IPO. If it's totally free forever, that's a huge problem. But then suddenly I come up with the idea, what if Windows? If you're using Windows XP, Windows 2000, they charge you like every year? No. As long as they're using same Windows, you don't have to pay money every year. Oh, maybe we can adapt this idea. So as long as you use the latest Windows version, you don't have to pay. So we just eliminate the update fee. At that time, our share was 14%, but it's up to number one, actually. So we beat Trend Micro, Symantec being number one, 2007-8. And then, so we went IPO after we break the $100 million, and then we ship the update fee zero security software.
Yeah. Oh, I see. So it sounds like the worst nightmare for incumbent firms when there's a new scrappy startup that comes in and then shifts the way that a lot of core services are offered or products are offered, different pricing model. Consumers are happy, margins are going down for the incumbents that were charging a lot or for subscription fees, but you're fine with that because you're smaller and you're having you're optimized for that kind of thing.
And nothing to lose.
Right, right, yeah. So how was the IPO process? When did you decide, okay, we need to IPO? Mm-hmm. Or?
IPO actually was fun for me, yeah. I think it's most of the public company CEO, don't go IPO. It's a pain in the neck every quarter, you know, headache every quarter. But almost 10 years has passed since Sonsix went IPO. I'm still having a fun. I'm very optimistic. so it's good. It's good. I think it's everybody say good to maybe hire brilliant people, but not only that. This is checking stock price every day. Yeah, that's okay. And then if not this public company, I don't know, to go IPO, of course, I got to hire external directors. Some people don't like it, but actually this really helps. They have so many experienced people there to teach us how to run the company. I'm so lucky to have a great external directors. And if I'm not a public company, of course, these people don't work for me. So, it's good.
I see. Okay, so then Silicon Valley.
Yes.
At what point did your focus go to Silicon Valley and leading up to the decision to move over here?
So first time I came over here, when I signed a deal with McAfee, that's 1999, so that was 17 years ago. But after that, I go to Silicon Valley maybe every 3 months, 4 months, stay there three days, 4 days. that worked, but when 2010, when I signed a contract with Evernote, and then CEO of Evernote say, hey, why don't you come over to take on my 300-day blue sky? I thought, well, this is a great idea. And actually, I tried 2011. I tried to stay 2 weeks here. And 3 days, 4 days trip, this is really difficult for me to make a deal because maybe a good discussion with the people. But, well, okay, Nori, so what the next meeting? And then, oh, sorry, next meeting will be maybe I'm going back to Japan. But if I stayed 2 weeks, it worked very well. And then I tried 4 weeks next year, which is 2012. That really worked. I made a deal over five companies. So what if I stayed forever? Maybe I could make lots of deals. And when I stayed at 4 weeks, I didn't go back to Japan. I just stayed there. I rented a house. So I think in terms of business, really, as you said already, being here as a CEO is really, really worked.
Interesting, yeah. And that's our first introduction where somebody had said, yeah, you know, there's a company where just the CEO lives here. And it's interesting. And one of the interesting stories that you like to tell here and there that I wrote about too is, so there was a difference between first you're living here, but then you brought your family over.
Yep.
And then people like to think from afar that, so in Silicon Valley or in the US more generally, things are more cut and dry, where it's just arm's length deals and then rational choices and this and that in business. But you were saying you discovered that once you brought your family over, and if there's a weekend barbecue you bring with your family, then all of a sudden, all these networks, yeah.
Yeah, that worked. Yeah, I did. Actually, I forgot to tell you. Actually, from the beginning, I brought my family.
Right.
So that was the key. I think in Japan, they're checking many things, but they didn't involve the family. But here, I think they're checking family more. They're not using DNB, credit company, like he said. Yeah. So yes, I was invited to some families. We didn't make a deal for at least 2 years. But after we met, got together everywhere among families, and then deal was done. Amazing. And so that was the key. I think it's if we have a single person here, even as a CEO, it's kind of not good. It's because we usually bring over. So now what I do here almost every week about family party involving lots of people with kids.
Yeah, so the message of establishing sort of interpersonal relationships as a personal, that's something that needs to be stressed more to more people.
They're watching everything. They're looking how your kids behave, how your wife behaves. I think this is very interesting.
Can you tell us a little bit about Evernote? Let's go back to there, because that's one of the interesting success stories where there's a Silicon Valley startup that's growing, but then it goes to Japan and uses the Japan market to grow really rapidly, which then helps it grow rapidly everywhere else. And Phil Libin tells great stories of how it was great. This is during the context when many people were saying, well, Japan is a difficult market for Silicon Valley startups. It's very different and this or that. And he went in and said, well, actually, it's not that different. It's very easy if you do certain things. Mm-hmm. And then if it works in Japan, then it works elsewhere. But then later I learned, oh, you were right in the middle of that. Mm-hmm. And you were the critical key to making this work. Can you tell us a bit about?
Yes. I met Phil, CEO of Evernote, May 25th. 2010, I really clearly remember that. And actually, we shipped product at the July 5th. So only 40 days since I met him. That was, oh, by the way, I brought some package, so maybe. Oh, listen, this one. This is the Evernote package that we shipped at 2010. So it's a first cloud package on the planet.
Cloud
that was people even asked to introduce. And we done a press conference June 15th, 2010. So yeah, their speed was amazing. And the great thing about them is tremendous, I mean, brilliant people, and also CEO, Phil Levin, let us decide for marketing totally. Usually, oh, you cannot use this, oh, don't do that. For example, to create this package, they let us do, because Nori knows everything about Japan. So you decide everything. So that's amazing. Usually people say, oh, you have to change this, or green is not good, why should be this, oh, you got to change this one. They didn't tell anything about this. This was amazing. Without this, I think not so successful like this. Yeah, and then product itself was really good. Yeah. At that time, they have 3 million people, registered users. Now over, of course, 200 million. But they're very good.
I see. Yeah, because one of the things that I've also looked over a lot of time in many different industries is Japan entry, market entry strategies, and finding the right partner is often very difficult. Also, the degree to which you let the local partner decide things versus the degree to which you say, our core competence is doing things our way. And sometimes one way works really well, sometimes another way works. But was this your idea to sell what's essentially a downloadable app for a smartphone in a box for the Japan market? So Phil said, so you want to sell our app in a box at stores?
Yeah.
Was there maybe Phil was okay with it?
Were other people? Yeah, Phil was okay with it. Yeah.
Yeah. Were other people in the teams thinking, or was it just okay? Phil said, okay, trust Matsuda-san. He knows the local market. He's done this. He knows what the packages should look like. He has the retail networks. This is how to sell in Japan. Was it sort of?
Yes, and like there's Hokamura-san. He really knew about the Japanese market, so he really helped us. So that was, yeah. And also with Alex, and he also helped us. Yes, the sourcing concept was very simple when I started this company. Basically, for non-Japanese company, it's, as you said, Japan market, it's really, really difficult. Almost nobody speaks English. And tech support has to be Japanese. And many things, all the product has to be localized. They don't like English menu, right? So, and then also at that time, also hiring people is very, very difficult and very expensive. And also renting office is very, very expensive. So many obstacles to get into Japanese market. Yeah. But sourcing's concept is very simple. You don't have to do anything. We do everything. We talk to retailers. We take care of all the returns. We create a box with our cost, not their cost. We don't charge you any marketing fund. If we do TV commercial, we don't charge you. So basically what you do is you don't need to even have an office here in Japan. So you have no risk. Just what you do, receive the checks from SourceNext. Or if you like to come to Japan, just come over to have an authentic sushi or sake. That's the SourceNext concept. Yeah.
So then coming to Silicon Valley and then making more deals, and then especially maybe after the Evernote deal too, what are some of the things that you discovered just by being here for a while about, say, bringing new software to Japan, what are some of the views that you formed? What's special about Silicon Valley?
So Silicon Valley is so special, yes, because it's the center of everything, especially IT. So yeah, for me, being here is really normal. Yeah, but I realize that there are 3,600 public companies in Japan. I'm only one person as a CEO to live in Silicon Valley. Because I belong to the IT sectors, Silicon Valley is maybe covers almost 99% of the IT industry. And even their headquarters is not in Silicon Valley. So some subsidiary here. We are making deal with Romanian company or German company. Almost all of the company have subsidiary here. So if I'm here, I can talk to everybody. I don't have to go to even Romania or India. They have all subsidiaries. So this is really, in terms of the efficiency, this is the best place.
That's a really important point. Yeah. Everybody else is in Silicon Valley too. So you come here and you can meet everybody here instead of point around there.
Yeah.
You've done a lot of work with India too, right?
India. I've been to India over 100 times actually. But I don't have to go frequently now, so because I'm here, so it's easy for the Indian people. Actually, I have two Indian friends, and they're coming over to my house tomorrow morning and evening. Yeah, so because that I'm in Silicon Valley, if I'm in Japan, no way to talk to them. This is good. Yeah.
I see. So you go to India much less now that because you live here.
Yes.
That's very interesting. Yeah. So, and that's another point about being in Silicon Valley that matters. This is a place to get those kinds of networks.
Yeah. For me, networking is very, very important. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Asakura-san told me like SoftSense is like trading company for software. Yeah, I think this is a great keyword I got from Asakura-san. Yeah, but for in the terms of the trading company, Silicon Valley is a key for the, especially for IT sector company like SoftSense.
I see. So do you have advice for other Japanese? We have a lot of people here from different Japanese companies who have a foothold here. Their CEO does not live here. You're the only CEO of a listed company that lives here. But they are very interested in Silicon Valley. Any advice for how to approach?
To them?
Mm-hmm.
Let me talk to them?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm traveling back and forth to Japan, so I'd love to meet, if it's possible, as CEO. Maybe, because I belong to also Keizai Doyukai, so maybe I know some of them. I'd like to talk to them how great Silicon Valley is. I mean, in terms of business. And also, not only that, with the view, you can see everything from here. If you stay in Japan, you can see only a part of the world, right? So, but here, you can see everything, I think. That's the most important. And if you live in Japan, it's almost always so many meetings. Here, you can also consider a lot, you can think of the strategy more dense. More dense. So that's, I think it's good too. Yeah.
I see. By the way, do you control your own schedule or do other people control it?
I control my schedule, basically. Yeah. But in Japan, of course, we should have some meeting. Still retailers, that's, I gotta go back. But actually, if I work both sides, this is good. In terms of efficiency, because Nori is in Silicon Valley, so when he comes back to Japan, we have to have a lot of meeting for him. There's so much meeting in Japan, and then when I'm in Japan, a Silicon Valley company say, "Oh, Nori is going to Japan, so we should set up the meeting this week, not next week." Mm-hmm. So everything is accelerated. It's good for me.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Busier and busier, it's good for actually business.
Right. If your presence is a scarce resource, then more efficiency if you can, higher productivity if you squeeze it in. Oh, interesting. Some types of management studies do point out that if CEOs do have control of at least some of their schedule, this is better too, because if your whole day is all scheduled for you, you then become closer to a mikoshikei or a just being carried around to what other people are making you do, and you don't have as much autonomy. But if you're physically not there for much of the time, but are available, mm-hmm. then it frees you up. Well, that's a very interesting perspective. So since you mentioned Doyukai, and then, of course, the Business Association, and then there's Keidanren, the two big ones in Japan. So you work with the Japan Association of New Economy, Shinkeizai Renmei. Many people here, particularly, and part of our audience is people outside Japan who are interested in what's going on. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about this new industry association?
Yes. This is three principles: globalization, innovation. entrepreneurship. This is a three principle we're looking for all the time.
And it was established in 2011,
yeah.
Right?
Originally 2000, I think it's 10, oh, okay. And then changed to JANE, Japan mm-hmm. Associated Economy, in 2012. Mm. Yes, we are playing a different role from Keidanre. We are more IT focused. We are more new economy focused. So that's really a changing, I think, Japan. Yeah, a lot. Yes.
So you have policy making, sort of policy proposal function.
Yes.
You have the annual summit, the new economy summit.
Yes.
That brings and. Thank you for inviting me a couple years ago.
We
had a nice panel about Stanford and Silicon Valley. But and I do think that that hasn't been advertised enough over here, where the caliber of people that that JANE has been able to get in Japan from Silicon Valley, Larry Ellison of Oracle and the founders of Box.com and Lyft and Andy Rubin, who made Android, such a amazing lineup of people who all have been to Japan to then take part in this event, and they've seen them. I remember conversations with, say, the founder of Lyft, who was looking around, it was his first time in Japan, saying, what do you think our market would look like here? I saw what Uber did, but how do you think we can? And so bringing people to Japan for this kind of focal point is wonderful, too. Some of the policy things, the policy proposals and things, you were telling me there's a fair bit of success. What's some of issues?
Okay, for example, I have two or three examples for that. For example, education. I'm sure more and more English is needed in the next 10 years, 20 years. This is for sure. And also more and more programming skill is needed in the future, we think. So we totally changed the education system. So that's without JANE, without Japan Associated New Economy, we call JANE. So without JANE, could not be accomplished, I think. So we changed the education in terms of English and programming. It's from 2020, programming class will be implemented. The programming concept. It will be implemented from first grade in Japan, and then English class will start from third grade. It's from 2019. This is done, not only proposal executed, mm-hmm. And the other example was the receipt. In Japan, we should keep the physical receipt. But from next year, January 1st, 2017, even you take a picture or PDF, everything is regarded as a proof for the tax reason. So that's really changed. So that's, I think it's common sense here, but it's changing. That's without JANE, never be accomplished. Not tremendous number of things we did already, over 30, 40, 50. But this is three things, a good example of the we've done, I think.
Oh, great.
May I interrupt for a second?
Me? Thank you.
This is the part that he's going to cut. Okay, that's really interesting. And you're director of this. Do you remember how many members are in?
521 companies at 9 directors of JANE.
Oh, I see.
And the representative is Mikitani-san, CEO of Rakuten. And Fujita-san also.
Cyber agent, yeah. Okay, great. So, thank you so much. If anybody has questions, we have about 10 minutes.
The subject, they haven't come up yet. There are about, 30, 40 people here, and there was 1, 2, 3 women, young women. One left, so it's only 3 now. Now, one thing you didn't touch, Mr. Matsuda, that didn't mention, it was very unique role of his own wife. You know, the his wife is the second to the top from the top from after him, and he's a mother. Excuse me, she's a mother, and works works as a executive of the company. And I would like to hear what is her role in your company, and what do you think that those are, you know, very smart looking ladies here, what can they play in the Japanese company in the future or any place? Did I make myself?
We do the different role totally. I mean, I do more fancy part, fun part, sales and development. And she does all the non-fun part, personal, legal things, or management things. Yeah, I think it's women, I don't know, not generally. I don't know, I cannot say maybe generally, but it's good at judging the people good or not. I'm totally easily to be deceived by people. I don't know. It's in so many cases where the koe is also couples. And then it looks like koe's Erikawa-san, I forgot her name. Keiko Erikawa-san does more sales. And then husband does for development. And maybe just system also the wife does for development. And then so I think it's, I don't know, so many different roles. But in my case, I do for sales, development, she does for personal, legal, other things. Yeah, so this is, I think, a good balance.
So just to be clear, you co-founded SourceNext with your wife.
Yes.
And she's been, so you basically have a two-headed leadership, and you're doing this one, and she's,
yes.
See, so she's, I guess formal title is vice president or
executive vice president.
I see.
But it's a I didn't mention about it, but bigger challenge for me and my wife come over here is how to run the Japanese company from U.S. That was the hugest challenge because nobody did it. But for me, I'm so lucky to have so many great employees who worked for over 10 years. It's almost 30 or 40% of the employee worked for 10 years. So I thought, oh, it's easy for them to do it by themselves. So usually, I think there are two cases. If we find a company in US, maybe most company does is, hey, we're gonna send this person who speak English, smart people, and then just send over to US. And make him run the company, make her run the company. But this is actually more risky because they have to fire people, but they don't know anything about this. But if we go there, it's easy for us to run the Japanese company because so many reliable people already in Japan. So that was, we thought. Yeah. It took a little time to convince our external directors. But they agree upon because but a public company, I think it's the profit is very, very important. But after move to here, still we are updating the new record of the profit. So it's now 7 years in a row. So that's okay.
After moving here, you've kept breaking your record
still,
for profits. So
yes,
that's interesting. So. Other questions or comments? Something tells me many people want to line up and ask you privately all sorts of questions about, here's our situation, what do you think about this? But anything else that we'd like to ask Matsuda-san? Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you for the explanation about your experience and success stories. And your explanations. One of the key success factors is it was like getting the opinion from the customers, local customers, and how to make it happy for them. But now you are away from those people. And of course you have many staff. But maybe because you are away, away from the, those people, is there any difficulty to get some good point of how to make happy for the next?
Oh, yes. Thank you. When I moved to Silicon Valley, I did many things. Because I'm away from them, me employees, or also customers. This is very important. So I do more like micromanagement now. So daily report has to be, they have to write a daily report to me. I mean, to, of course, manager, but CC to me. I always write some response to them. That's what I do. And every time I go back to Japan, I have a party, like a per se party a monthly. Not only that, some any kind of excuse party. So that's I do, and I try to hear from them. And also every day I get some opinion from real customers. That's how we have a system. So we have over 30 million people registered users in Japan, and every time they buy, they give us some response. I mean, maybe 10% of the people at least, they write some opinion. And every day, I read that, the email. So you're right. I'm really afraid of that. I'm really worried about I'm being away from customers. But in place of that, I got to do this. That's what I'm decided to do. Yeah. So now it works, I think. But as customer, not only the end users, also the people here like Evernote or Dropbox, they are also customers. So I'm more close to these customers, developers. So yeah, I think, yeah, pros and cons, but I think it's now working. Thank you.
Thank you for a great presentation. Actually, as you both of you mentioned,
huge difference between the Silicon Valley and Tokyo is one of the difference are the kind of the speed, as you mentioned. And I'm now working for the commercial bank, Japanese commercial bank, and it's quite huge and have a many kind of bureaucratical some structure. So do something, we need to process a huge number of approval or some discussion or many meeting, but it's quite tough to change that system totally immediately. But we need to catch up the world global innovation. How do you think that like traditional Japanese company, large Japanese company, including commercial bank, should change in order to catch up such moving first global change?
But I think, I don't know, it's depending on the company, but I think most of the good, great executive have some experience to, they never worked in foreign countries, that's what they're saying. Mostly they stay in Japan.
Yeah, most of them are staying in Japan because they have some relationship with their core customer based in Japan. And fortunately or unfortunately, our business is a large portion of our business is based in domestic. So they need to stay in Tokyo, and it is quite difficult for them to stay in Silicon Valley for a couple months. So maybe they cannot get how actually the world is changing quickly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I think as long as they are making money in Japan, I think they can take risk. Compared to other countries, I think I've been to India, I've been to other countries, their market size is not so huge as Japan. So I think they have more handicap than Japan. I think the most important is changing mind. But somehow, maybe your question is how to change their mind. So they are in Japan now.
Yeah. Should we assign, should they, the top management assign there some responsibility to someone saying US?
That's very important, yeah. I think, but it's, I think next 10 years, maybe it's gonna change. More and more young people go up to the upper positions. I think we should have more and more chance for them to bring over to Silicon Valley. Is that possible? Well, I love to talk to that kind of company's executive, if possible, because it's, I think in terms of business, this is really, really important and to be here. And this is really, before I live here and after I live here, totally my mindset was changed. Because I thought, everybody say, oh, I understand, because maybe they think, maybe I thought, I understand Silicon Valley. Okay, Silicon Valley is like countryside, nothing there, right? Or so many great people, like Steve Jobs, Larry Page, Mark Zuckerberg, but it's totally different area. It's not, it's the IT industry, it's different. But here is more like everybody trying to contribute to the society. That's, I think, a very good concept. The reason why I set up this company, also I like to increase the contribution to the society. That's why I found the company. So I think somehow we should have some conference with some successful CEO here, try to change their mind, and try to bring over, not for a short time, 3 days, 5 days, it's as long as possible. If possible, let them live here. That, I think, eventually we should do, I think.
So when Keidanren sends a big delegation set here, we'll ask you to show up and then help the process. Maybe last question, and then we'll have plenty of time for networking since we have the room until 6 o'clock, and we can ask Matsuda-san directly.
I have a few simple questions. So you said you are the only person and as a CEO living here and working here. Do you have office outside of home or do you work
office.
From home?
I have office, yes. Okay. And I hire the person.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
That's one thing. And then the second thing is that my understanding is that you are here to more like find a new software or services that you can possibly import to Japan to sell. And then how do you find these kind of new companies or software? Do you go to the event or do you... Because you are getting more famous and then people come to you, your office to
both,
meet you?
Yeah. People come to Japanese office, or Silicon Valley, or by LinkedIn, many, many, many ways, yes. Mm-hmm. Or by introduction, mm-hmm. The people. Yeah, the reason why actually I'm in Silicon Valley, three reasons actually. Find a great product. This is easy. Second, find a great like tools. Because in Japan, I didn't know even go to meeting. Or so many great customs, like a family party. In Japan, only employees, mm-hmm. but not with wives, mm-hmm. not with kids, but I started to do 4 years ago. And the third one, this is the ultimate goal, actually, create a global product from here. That's why I'm here. And we're going to sell our product starting from January 5th in the CES. So that's what I do. So. Yeah, for the introduction of how to find a company, yeah, many ways. Mm. So through the people, through the party, I also have a party. Yeah, hold a party, yes.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Well, on that note, so you said you're going to roll out something, yeah, in January. So in another year or two, we'll be able to do this again, and you'll say so. And the next continuation of this story is then CEO lives here, and then has global rollout of things mm-hmm. from here, harnessing Silicon Valley. So yes. We're looking forward to that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you for joining us.